Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Maxon booth here in Las Vegas, Nevada. NAB 2019, a really big year for us here. Redshift has joined the Maxon family. For more information on that, check us out at maxon.net. If you guys are checking out the stream, everybody on stream, hello, YouTube, everybody on the interwebs, make sure you get your chance to win over $25,000 of prizes by visiting c4dlive.com and registering. Yes, you too. Well, I don't know if you can qualify. Don't do it. Give it to them.
So someone register for me.
Someone register for Casey. So over $25,000 of prizes we're giving away. You have to register between now and the end of the show, which is tomorrow afternoon. We've also been nominated for Product of the Year, and that's a big thing here at NAB, Product of the Year at NAB, so we have a nomination there. And we actually won an Oscar for mograph. So really big congratulations to everybody in the community and the whole crew of mograph artists and all the developers on the team. So up next, longtime friend, longtime community member, a wizard of particles and so many other things in Cinema 4D, let's give a big round of applause to Casey Hupke.
Thank you, guys. Thank you. This is more reasonable of an audience to present to. My Monday morning was rough. So, yep, that's me, Casey Hupke. I'm doing an abstract on abstract motion design. I wish I was better at typography, because then I could have actually, like, taken those and put it actually on that, and would have been like a dad joke mixed into design, and it had a whole meta thing going on. So, like I said, my name is Casey Hupke. My voice is somewhere out there, and I'd love to get it back, but I can't. So I'm going to talk really kind of weird and slow. I'm the motion design director, or director of visual effects. There's a transitionary title, but I'm at BlackBerry. I used to be at a company called Cylance. We were acquired by BlackBerry earlier this year, later last year, depending on the timeline. And yeah, what we basically do is, well, actually, let me show you my reel first, so you can see some of the other stuff I work on. Spoiler, lots of thin lines of particles. All right, wait on the music. Someone mute the music. That's my new reel. Thank you to my younger brother, Darren Hupke, for cutting that audio track for me. And whatever that After Effects script that I bought, automatic editor, best money I ever spent. That was all whoever made that plugins credit right there. So yeah, a lot of the stuff that you guys just saw was energy in motion, communication, things, moving between things. None of it looks like anything. No one ever has ever been able to photograph what data looks like, except for in the instance of like hard drive space visualization, they have figured it out. But so I get the task of like trying to figure out what threats look like, what AI should look like, what traffic on the network should look like. And at BlackBerry Cylance and at Cylance, one of the big projects that we have every year is sort of what our booths are going to look like for that year. And the booth design, creative director Drew Hoffman and myself, we like to collaborate, and Chris Cook, To and Flow, go to bed. We like to like kind of like push the envelope a little bit, and you know, try to stay away. We have a big the cybersecurity, right? So green is going to be there. So we try to use green as much as possible and lean away from it as much as possible, so that we don't stand out too much. But we also don't want to, you know, make too many waves. We're disruptors though, so we get some leeways. To disrupt myself, if you saw my presentation on Monday, I'm going to be doing this presentation in reverse to put the highlight on this liquid metal package. So, like I said, every year we come up with a trade show package. That package then gets broken out into a whole bunch of individual videos for social, banner ads, product inserts, and all this other stuff. So let me go ahead and show you what the liquid metal package looks like. This script B element right here. Oh, someone changed the default away from VLC. It's cool, we can fix it. So we make a lot of products. These little animations on the right here, these are the characters that we cast to convey what our product does. This, you can see there's red things coming in, those are bad things, and it's being protected by Cylance Protect. This one, it's a product called Cylance Optics. That little circle right there is looking between all these little things that represent endpoints and trying to find the red things, which are... That's right, I can't talk, I told you guys, so you're going to help me out. And then, so yeah, basically you get it. We make all these little simple animations that we use to define what our products look like, feel like, and emulate as on screen at our booth to draw people in and come learn more about them. I'm always really proud with what we come up with here, and we always like to do little cheats and little hacks to kind of save time, because you can see how long this video is. It's about 3.5 minutes. This is video one. The first video, this is more the anthematic version of the video that we play at the booth on the gigantic screen. And when we're trying to come up with these ideas, we're trying to think about how to render them out optimally, how to get them out quick, how to review fast. And everyone in cinema land knows that the fastest way to get animation feedback is do a play blast or a hardware render or something like that. This project delivered as a hardware render. This is all built in R19's OpenGL viewport with the enhanced features, the camera. We didn't use the depth of field for the final because we wanted to use fresh lift, but we're going to walk through this project and how we abuse the viewport to get this like sort of hacked out version of what we felt it looked like looking at the cybersecurity landscape through a different lens. So most of the stuff that we work on, I sort of laidenly put in these little jabs that are just basically marketing dad jokes, but no one but me is going to get them. So I just shared that one with you. This is the cybersecurity landscape through a different lens. Let's go ahead and check the slide, make sure the slide is do a demo. But I'm pretty sure it is. We don't need this slide right now. Where'd my mouse go? I've lost a mouse. The dinosaurs are taking over the park. The mouse will eventually come back online. There we go. There we go. Thank you. I was going to see how much I can get through. Now we'll do a demo. I bet I could do a lot of this without using a mouse. Challenge mode? All right. So let's set it up. We have this world, this big digital world. Yeah, it's back now. With this big little world of reflective objects and materials and stuff. The original Cylance graphic and branding campaign that came from was a thing that we did called Think Beyond. And it was basically this, like, it looked like a slide that you'd see in like biology or whatever. And like if you cracked it, all the ink and stuff would flow through it. So it was like a weird like green goo filled cracked LCD screen looking thing. And it was just a big imposing Think Beyond over it. And me and Chris had to figure out like, okay, what does that look like moving? So what we did was we decided to use that specific image as the environment for our scene and then just reflect on that and let it warp and undulate across the surface. As I mentioned on Monday, every motion design project has to have at least one tunnel. So we started with our tunnel shot and built it out from there. So let's go ahead and start building out the basics for our tunnel. And as we get some basic geometry in here, we will go ahead and start turning on the viewport action, the viewport settings that are going to sort of drive how this looks and feel, how do we can make this like look and feel, or in the words of Mark Wahlberg, how it can look good, feel good. Let's go ahead and create a displacer so that our torus has a little bit of movement and action going on in the points. This will help activate what's happening in the reflections and all the surfaces and also give us a little cheat of what I like to do. I use noise in everything. Like if I can use this as a driver for animation, like when I really like GSG Signal for this too, because I hate keyframes. Ever since that Esponza no keyframes video for when 11.5 came out, I am, oh boy, let me try to not have a keyframe in my scene. That's all I want is no keyframes. So I'm going to go ahead and scale this up so it's a little more soft and cloudy. We're going to stick with the default noise, but if you don't like this noise and it's not the look that you want to go for, I like to go into this little drop down right here and take a look at what the other noise sort of look like. This default noise is, it's nice. It works for making nice, smooth surfaces. And I'm going to go ahead and leave it like that. Let's go ahead and turn up the intensity just a wee bit more. And I'm going to go ahead and give our subdivision or our torus object just a bit more resolution so that it sort of smooths out. This will also make me have to go back in and change my scale because I still want this kind of soft. There we go. Warbly. Now, under here, under animation speed, you can, if you just want to give yourself a keyframe, you can animate the offset of these noises, but you could also just go to this animation speed float input and give it a value, 1.1.999999, whatever you want. And once you hit play, you're going to see that that puppy is now animating. It's not actually a puppy, I know. But yeah, this is going to be the basis of our tubular structure. This will be the internet in a moment. And how we're going to create that internet-like object is we're going to make a spline, and then we're going to deform this geometry using spline wrap across that object. So let me go ahead and grab my pen tool from the drop-down menu. And let's go ahead. You can tell I have low energy right now because I actually went up here rather than just going like this. So I'm sorry, guys. Let's go back. Pen. Activate. Let's pan out just a little bit. Because that's not a tube. That's a well. I mean, motion design tunnel, not a motion design well. All right. That should be long enough. Now, this spline, although, you know, clearly drawn and point separated out like a master at his craft has created it, is not very great. So I'm going to go ahead and select all my points. I'm going to hit Shift-C, and I'm going to hit Round, not Resample. That's Houdini. And then I'm just going to go ahead and go like this, adjust my points. Why is it not rounding? I think my display options are getting messed up. So let's go back to All, Round. There we go. Let's bring it back down just a little bit. That'll give us some relatively even point distribution. It's not great, but it's more rounded. And now on our torus object, I'm going to select this, and I'm going to create a spline wrap. The spline wrap is going to take in an input of a spline, and it's going to deform this object. So this torus, which is already getting hit by a displacer, I'm going to pass a spline wrap to it. Now, initially, it's just going to do that. But if I go into my torus and change the orientation of how it's created, I can get a tunnel. Boom, we are halfway there. Honey, I'm being home for dinner tonight. So we got our tunnel, and this tunnel we can actually go ahead and define some changes to it. If we manipulate our points, we can get little curves and ripples and stuff. And another really great thing that we can do, we've already got this displacer doing some animated noise. If we just control and drag to the spline, we can have an additional layer of animation happening on our points here. I don't believe I have to change that into point mode because it's already operating in point mode. But just so we can see that it's animated a little differently, let's go ahead and just dramatically change the speed. All right, cool. Now we got like a wiggly waveform happening in it, but that's obviously far too dramatic. Let's run it back down to like 0.3 or something because I just want this tube to have like a slow undulation. In my displacer, I'm going to go ahead and adjust the height so that way we get a little bit of a wave. And then in my shading, I'm going to go back to my noise. And I actually want this to be much flatter. And actually, I just wanted to show you guys that we can add some additional animation there, but I think it's going to complicate where I'm going to go next, so I'm going to just kill it for the purposes of this presentation. Just wanted to show you guys that you can take the tools that you're using for one object or one operation and go ahead and apply different tools and effects to it. All right. So now that we got it looking like this, how do we get it looking like this? Well, what we're going to do is go ahead and hit Alt-V in the viewport to bring up the Enhanced OpenGL tab. And we're just going to turn all of them on. Shadows, post effects, transparency, noises. Reflections is important, because reflections by default, let's go ahead and make a material first. I just double-clicked it here to make a material. The thumbnail won't update until I've stopped playing in the editor just so I can keep a smooth situation going. I'm going to drag my material on here. So it's got a little specularity now. It's got a little bit of reflectance, but it's not what we want. We want this thing to basically reflect the entire environment. So in order to do that, what we're going to need to do for now is turn this down to a darker color. And in reflectance, we're going to change this to GGX, which is going to be like more of like a car material will look like. So a little shinier. I'm going to turn the roughness down because we don't want our reflection to be too obscured or messed up. And then we're also going to go ahead and crank our reflection up. Now, if anyone on the internet, anyone on Maxon watching, know where this HDR came from or the location of it, I would love to know. It just has like a fun fact. But our generic reflection setting, it's already coming through. We've already got that very metallic object look happening in the viewport. But I want to use my own reflection in the environment. Now, I'm not even going to use like an HDRI or anything. I'm going to go to my liquid metal folder, and I'm going to grab one of the images that we rendered from the final project. In the project itself, we used an image that the graphic design team and the design team at Cylance created, and we used it in the viewport there. But since this is basically just like a double reflection of that exact technique, I think it's fine for this one as long as you guys are cool with it. All right. So boom, immediately we've got our reflection in the environment, and it's if we hit play, this still image appears to have animation. I was pretty excited by that because it led to all the particle animations and stuff that we're going to start putting in there kind of become their own thing and live on their own and have their own little characteristics. So when you're thinking about how data moves around or data gets messed up or threats come in and steal things, there's always like a ripple or whatever, you know? There's a ripple effect to how things happen. So again, internal dad joke to help drive abstract design. Abstract design is 99% dad jokes. So let's go ahead and now this looks a little flat. And in our viewport, the reason why this looks flat is because by default, if I hit Control D, we've got this linear workflow on. So I'm just gonna turn it off, which is gonna give me a little better saturation in the viewport. I'm gonna do a lot of things in here that your compositor or the person who's doing the color is going to be like, why are these things not looking right? You're not delivering to me to the final thing. But again, I'm going to render out with a hardware renderer anyway, so I'm already doing things the wrong way. All right, so we got this object going. It's undulating. It's doing its thing. We're seeing some action. We don't quite have enough resolution, so I want to make it a little bit smoother. I'm going to use a subdivision surface just to get some extra smoothness on there. All right, so the scene starts to slow down again, but it's not slowing down that far. Our FPS is still well in the 20s, and that to me says like, oh, that means that I'm going to be nearly rendering inside of 20 frames per second. That's pretty exciting to me. Next, we need to move through this object. So let's create a camera, and our camera is going to have another few viewport and OpenGL hacks that are going to help us make this look extra special. And if I go to physical and I give my realistic depth of field value that could totally happen in the real world, you can see that I start to get these bokeh motes. Bokeh motes. And they just sort of flicker and glint in as they're animating, which is a great additional effect. Normally you'd be in Frischlift or be in After Effects or Fusion or what was the other one? Shake? Motion? And then you'd use a plugin, blur it out, and you wouldn't be rendering at 20 frames per second, that's for sure. So when we did this, we rendered it out super big mode, 6K, 8K, brought it back down to 1080p to get rid of some of the aliasing and stuff that you're seeing in there. There are other GL settings that we can start to tweak to get this a little bit more like kind of honed in and railed in. I just hit Control E. Let's go to OpenGL. They may still be, all right, cool. We have mapping on. We can just, you know, kind of roll through them real quick. But yeah, I have everything cranked out as much as it can go in here. So the only other real way to get this where we want it to go is by tuning our viewport to support what we want. So let's go ahead and turn on none to get rid of everything. Let's hit Control E, and let's go to our scheme colors and note to self. at the end of this demo. Change this background color back so no one comes and freaks out. We're going to go ahead and bring our background down to like something not true black, because even in the world of fantastical data visualizations for cybersecurity, the color true black does not look good as a background. It just looks like someone left a layer off on your render. Never use true black, never go all the way to the white, stay somewhere in the middle. 3 is the percentage of black that I'm comfortable with using, and that's just what I like, dang it. Okay, so we got nothing. Under filter, let's start bringing our objects back in. I'm going to hit polygon. You're not going to see anything. I'm going to hit subdivision surface, and you're going to think, why don't you see subdivision surface? This was when I hit an anxiety wall on my last presentation. I forgot, under the heat of these lights, that SDS mesh and subdivision surface have to be enabled so that you can see a subdivision surface in the viewport. All right, so we've gotten rid of everything in our scene except for our subdivision surface that's animated, and that's it. That we have our animated texture and reflections happening on this object. So when I was a wee lad and I was first getting started in Cinema 4D, the idea of having this as a render that I could then take into something else and composite and make something, I would have been so stoked for this. So seeing this, I was like, all right, let's get into it. All right, so I'm going to go ahead into my camera. I'm going to give this a line to spline tag. I'm going to drag the spline down onto it. And, it's probably since I drew it from the other way, if I go to 100%, we'll probably back at it. Let's go ahead and change it to tangential to, I know it's going to, hey, come on, there we go. Now we're inside the tunnel. We're moving through the tunnel. We have a little warble and a wiggle. And whatever we want to do, however we want to redefine and rechange our object or our internal motion design wild tunnel down, we're going to be able to do that just by manipulating that one spline right there. So again, we're going to have to go back up to our filter preset, change our points here. And also, we're going to need to put some other stuff back on. For now, I'm not going to worry about adjusting the spline. We're just focusing on building out this scene. We need some lights. So I'm going to go ahead and hit Shift-C and not use that. What tag was that? Light tag. That's not going to do anything. All right, so Shift-C, type light, add a light. You can see that it updated the way the scene looks a little bit. I'm going to make this be sort of like a headlight for our object to give us a little extra oomph. And within that light, I'm going to go ahead and change it to an area light. And we're working in untitled 3 asterisk. Okay, that lockup was enough for me to go ahead and say, let's save. Liquid metal, NAB, C4D. Nailed it, dude. Underscore 12B, final 2. All right, we got our light. Let's go ahead and turn on shadows. And let's go ahead and crank up the intensity just a little bit. So we'll start getting some peak shadows that are hitting over the edge now. We're starting to use this light itself to sort of become a compositing element. So if I were to go ahead and swing this light to a greener color or a bluer color, I can sort of start doing like a hue shift to the surface of the object itself. So we're inside this, but we're missing all those particles, those little FUI bits that we had in the other thing. So I'm going to go ahead and take a moment to set up just a little one that we worked on, and stick it just real, real minimal. I'm going to do it in a new file that I'm going to bring in this one and show you guys what's going on. So I'm going to go ahead and go to filter, turn everything back on again so we can create this. I'm going to make an end side. I'm going to change its orientation to BXZ, which I have set as default for my object, which you can do by going right-click, save as default. This will make everyone else that you work with very upset, so don't do it. But when you work alone, you can do it. Make a cloner object. This cloner object is going to iterate or instance our end side. I'm going to change this to a honeycombed array. And again, I'm going to change it to the correct orientation. And now we're going to want to affect these objects to create one of these blippy bloopy fun things, or as Kayleen at Cylance would say, one of those like whooshy wishy particle thingy videos that you make, which I refer to as haute couture data films. Now let's play with these clones. Let's get them to do something and animate. So I'm going to make a plane effector. the newest, the goddess of all god effectors, as a bunch of us were just discussing out there. In 19, the shader effector was the god effector. In 20, the plane effector in fields is everything in the world. So a plane effector, and how do you want to? What do we want the plane effector to do to the cloner object? Right now, it's just pushing it up in, by a unit of 100 in the y-axis. I'm going to set this to absolute scale, 0, and I'm going to give it a disk as source falloff. So drop it in here, and you'll see why I'm doing the disk in just 1 second. I'm going to make a circle, because again, I don't like to really have to do keyframes, but for this, we're going to keyframe it, and I'm going to take this disk, and I'm going to align to spline again, and I'm going to drop this circle on it, and I'm going to go ahead to this circle, and I'm going to change it to the correct orientation, and I'm going to scale this circle up a bit. You can see that some of our plane effect, some of our objects are already starting to be hit by that action. Now, what I want to do is I want to set a keyframe, begrudgingly. Let's go to 0 to 100. This is going to be way too fast. And then I'm going to go ahead and go right-click, animation, show track. If I hit tab, you can see there's a basic ease here. I'm just going to go ahead and hit Alt-L to make it linear. You saw the icon up there change, I hope. Quick math. All right, so now it's moving, and we got blips, we got bloops. In the FUI world, that's a layer right there, baby. So what I can do here, and the reason why I'm using this disk and not like another object for fall off, is that I can control the points that are on the various, if I go ahead and go to display and quick shading lines. So every point that is in between all of those quads on this plane effector in the fall off under this field, the radius of those points are what drive this effect. So if I go to this this disk and say that there's only one segment there, my animation is different than 12. I can adjust the rotation segments. And this is one of those little things where you do like a weird abstraction of a tool and you change it. It makes it look a little different. It makes it look less stock. It makes it look your own. Even if it just looks like a fall off or a feel that's there, you know that you basically built a custom effector to drive this and really only using one little simple trick. So I'm going to go ahead and use our displacer again. And I'm going to hit enter on that. Now I'm going to drop the displacer under the disk. And in my parameter, I'm going to give it a noise again. And under my displacer, I'm going to give it more strength so we can see what's going on here. What I'm going to do here is push these points and push them around a little bit so they're just kind of junked up and thrown around. And then again, inside my shading, and again, sorry for the default noise, everyone playing the hashtag motion design or motiongraph.com bingo or drinking game, I use the default noise and 36 millimeter camera so far. I'm going to use the set animation speed to 1. And now, let's go a little more dramatic just for this effect. All right, let's get this kind of hierarchically structured a little bit better. I'm going to select all these things and hit Alt-G. And now I'm going to turn off our disk from visibility. And so all I'm doing here is just making my own effector. That you could make your own thing with shape, with fields and shapes, whatever, but I like to start with a piece of geometry and use points to drive all the stuff. Okay, great. So now we got this going on. Now the next thing I'm going to do is set up a sweep. I'm going to sweep this geometry. Normally, I would just go ahead and render this out with hair or with a hair render, but for the next step, we need actual geometry to display as a post effect on the surface of the object. So I'm dropping a circle down to place at the top level of my sweep so that my inside gets bigger and becomes, wrong one, so that my inside starts getting a little bit of detail going on. All right, so now we have it animating. It's a renderable piece of geometry, and it's looking pretty cool. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and create a camera. I'm going to drop this camera inside here. I'm going to go ahead and zero everything out. I'm going to change this to negative 90, and I'm going to go ahead and move this up so that our camera is staring at this object. Let's go ahead and move it back up a little bit so we frame the whole thing. All right, cool. All right. So this will be the element that we use for our mograph camera shader. So we would make these little elements in X particles and in Cinema 4D, and then I would play around with projecting these as elements on our objects. So the top out of this camera, let's paste in our little FUI setup. Let's move it over to the side. And again, this you know, you could just render this out from your other project and bring it into this one and layer it in the way we're going to do it. But I thought it'd be really cool to do all the animation in one scene and not use a render engine. Totally obtuse challenge I put on myself, but myself and Chris sort of, I think we stuck the landing on it in the end. So I'm going to go ahead and go to color, and I'm going to load up from the MoGraph tab the camera shader. The camera shader itself allows me to take what a camera sees and create a make it, it basically makes lets it display on the surface. So let's make sure we have all our post effects stuff on. That's our camera shader. It should see it. Oh, am I in some kind of crazy render engine? Is my friend crazy? Man, I just set this up. Oh, it's my light. It's my light. Okay, let me turn off my light, make sure this renders, and let's go back over here. No light going on inside of here. But you guys see on the surface over here? Let's hop out of our depth of field camera for 1 second. It's stretching out here, but let's hit play. You'll start to see the little MoGraph bits. Let's turn off our spline wrap so we can visualize a little better. All right, trying to move over to it. My middle mouse button's now, this mouse. The challenge is today. Turn off subdivision surfaces in case that's hanging me up. Okay, so now we have our animated MoGraph FUI bit happening right there. And if I move my camera, I can change sort of where that element exists, almost like I'm animating or changing the offset. So if I just went over here and took it and sort of pitched it and looked at it from a different angle, I'm back to my main camera. Oh yeah, I'm aligned to spline on here. I'm gonna go ahead and just cut that off because right now we're getting to the point where we're gonna be sort of wrapping it up. Let's go ahead and also, in my camera, change our subdivision surface as my object target. So now we're starting to get those little FUI bits. Let's make the animation just happen a little bit more prominently, and that'll work. If I basically just get rid of this displacer, we should see a lot more. All right, hop back to our action camera. And yeah, so now we have the MoGraph camera shader working. If I hit render, you'll see that they're rendering on there and they're animating in the same scene. So the next step in this one was, no, that's basically it. Yeah, so we set up our none environment, our SDS mesh, our subdivision surface, our polygons, and our generator. Turn our spline effector back on. Man, this mouse is really giving me grief. After I walk off stage, this mouse is coming with me. It's all right. And then I think the last thing we can do inside of our camera is, I believe I turned it on, vignettes. So we can control the vignette in there as well as an additional set of animation support. If we go back here and put our light that we made under this object, that will allow us to light it as well. So when we go back to this object, now our shapes will take on another little iteration of change. So I'm just going to render it since we didn't light this very well in here. But the MoGraph camera shader is another little thing that I think really works in to kind of add like a little level of like displacement or obfuscation to the piece that you're creating. That being said, let me show you some of the redonkulous R&D that Chris and myself did during this project. So yeah, all this is all viewport. We'd just tweak our scheme settings and our scheme colors to create these, what I always refer to as like hardware LUTs or viewport LUTs. And then this all stemmed because of the project we're going to go into next. When we started actually doing hardcore renders with it, the creative director, Drew, was like, oh man, I really like the way those like playbacks that you guys were showing me looked. They just like, they look way more like scientific. Like they look like science films or whatever. And I was like, all right, great. Shipping hardware renders. This is amazing. And yeah, we do like some compositing on some of these elements and stuff. After fact, I mean, I guarantee you guys see Pixel Sorter all over this stuff. But yeah, that was Liquid Metal. Moving on, we're going to talk about a project we created called Cylance Endpoints. This was the first trade show package that we created. I will go ahead and show you. You want R&D first or regular one first? R&D first. Okay. So the concept and the idea behind Endpoints was this giant planet plus a motion design tunnel. They represented all the devices, hard drives, laptops, desktops, servers, endpoints, and everything else on a giant corporate network. Imagine this Death Star is Adobe's entire collection of devices visualized as one planet. And then our product is the green and blue and white particles that surround that object to protect it and insulate it. They parodied the frame, the positioning and the location of the endpoint themselves. It moved, and the idea was this visual reference was originally from Winderstat, visualizing a hard drive that had a whole bunch of random individual PNG frames. I just loved the way that it laid it out, and I was like, oh my god, I can't imagine, like, what if you had access to like all of Cisco or Adobe's machines and you just ran Winderstat on all of their machines at once? What would that hard drive visualization look like? Well, I tried to make it. And we'll go ahead and hop in and do a quick little explanation of the sketchbook creation of it. And to do that, we're going to start with a file in my NAB folder, C4D, CV parametric selection tag. This is a tool that Donovan Keith made for Cinema. It's a Python Python tag. The code's in there. I don't open it. I don't know what it says, so I'm not going to worry about it. But it has these great great pieces of flair that really drive home levels of detail in variants that I like to use in my projects. Okay, so let's just kind of move through this one a little bit quicker, because I'm talking about half as fast as I was on Monday, and I have about half as much less time. So let's go ahead and make this sphere editable, because we're going to do that whole hard drive visualization look up here. This is what we're going to make. The whole thing in full detail. I'm just kidding. We're going to make it like a much smaller version and probably only a couple layers. All right, so I've made it editable by hitting C, and I'm going to go ahead and everything should be on. I'm going to go to polygon selection mode. I'm going to make sure that only selected visual elements is on right now, because I don't want to deselect these and also select the ones on the backside, which I do a lot. And then I hit delete and it's gone. All right, so all I'm doing here is making space so that we have a tunnel to fly through later. And I'm getting rid of the polygons that are only triangles, because they don't really do the whole Griebel triangle extrude thing as well as quads. And for the purposes of time, we're not going to make a whole quadded sphere, which I believe is just I use a cube and a bulge. And I've seen how to do it on the internet. It exists. I'm also going to go ahead and make sure that in my options, I don't have backface culling on, because that's gonna hurt what I'm seeing here. So I've moved this Python tag over to the sphere. And I'm going to go ahead and initialize it. I'm going to create a new parametric selection tag. It just popped right there. It's named parametric. It is itself parametric. And I'm going to make a material so we can visualize what this tag is doing. Now, I'm going to tag this selection tag and drop it in here. And currently, it doesn't do anything. Also, this default color is going to drive me nuts. So I'm going to pick a nice, cool blue to represent our selected surface. I almost always use noise as a way to generate our selection. And as you see, when I clicked it, we're now selecting random faces based on the noise that's being generated. If I go into my bias, I can tweak to make it more or less selected. There's also an invert function in here somewhere, but for right now, we'll just go with this. Oh, there it is, invert. Okay, so now we got some cool selections. Now what I want to do with these selections is blow them away and get them out of the scene. I don't want the client, who's me, to come back and say, nah, those selections are all wrong. Do it again. Let's work on this. So that's why we're going to use poly effects and a plane effector to scale down the polys that we have selected. Now, I'm putting the plane effector under here just for myself because these are going to become layers later, and I don't want to lose this poly or this plane effector down the road. All right. That being said, I'm going to change my poly effect or my plane effector to scale down. Uniform scale, absolute. I'm going to give this source falloff again, but the source falloff this time is going to come from the Ultraman or woman matrix object, and I'm going to generate thinking particles with it. Thinking particles are points. These things exist as points, and they have values, and we can use them as a radius. I'm going to go ahead and go to matrix object, go to object mode, pass my selection, and also I'm going to open up my thinking particle settings and create a new group, pass the group to it, and we're only going to do one layer this time for the purposes of time. Okay, matrix object set to object mode. Object is sphere. Its selection is parametric, and I'm going to distribute it in the polygonal center. So now I have a point at the center of every single one of my my selected objects. So let's go ahead and create, let's open up our thinking particle setting again, go to our plane effectors fall off, and pass it group one as a source. Now I don't have to worry about ever coming back and changing my my base geometry. So if I, let's get back to object mode so I'm not seeing the things. Oh, this is gonna get rough. Let's go ahead and save this as DS demo. I knew it was gonna happen. All right, let's go ahead and kill the invert. I believe it's the invert that's happening it. This script, I don't believe, has officially been updated for R20. This did not happen to me on the first day, but anyway, I digress. All right, so we have all of our selections. They're being tweaked. If I go into my noise, I can change the animation, which will erode them differently. The next thing we're going to do is extrude those, so we're getting a greeble on. I'm going to use MoExtrude, which can be animated using mograph effectors. And I'm going to group these all and expect it to work like it should. And it did. But there's going to be some issues that will come up if I'm not careful. So in order to make sure the issues don't come up, and if you ever face an issue ever, at any point, at any time, with MoGraph, Dynamics, anything else, just put whatever you're trying to play with in a connect object. It's going to fix everything. And I'm going to go ahead and change this to highest, just so that my fongs and stuff don't look real weird. And remember, this is going to be a viewport render where we tweak and make our own hardware lot like we just did, only using separate stuff. All right, so we've got this connected object, but you'll notice that we don't have backs on these right here, and that's going to drive me nuts, because when we go and fly through the tunnel later, well, not today literally, but later and when we see the final render, if I didn't see the backs right there, I'd be like, nope, 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 figure it out. I don't care how. They need to have backs. So hit Shift-C and type instance. Instance is going to happen outside of the MoExtrude and do a nice little cap. The next thing we'll do on the top of this is make a connect object. And we'll take them all, put them all together in like a nice, happy family. So now we have what looks like a cubed or a bunch of cloners randomly placed on a bunch of objects. But this, in this instance, what we can do is let's make our scales all ones. I don't need it to taper in. But we can animate the height so we can get that cool stack. And if we create a shader effector to drive our MoExtrude, changing scale, going position, going Z, and then the shading, going to noise, Now we'll get some variation happening on that. Okay, so we got one layer going. Let's make sure this is in there too, just so we're all on one layer. Let's duplicate it. Let's rotate it just a bit. Things are gonna get a little twitchy because I'm currently only using one thinking particle group to drive the source fall off, and normally I would create a second one, but for the purposes of time, we're not going to. And now we're gonna create a subdivision surface, and before the extrude, we're gonna take this connected object and drop it in here, which is gonna give us a second level of subdivision on our surface. And you guys are kind of seeing how these simple little setups here are, oh yeah, and let's change this to bilinear open subdiv loop so that you guys can see that we have all these rounded things that are happening. Because the topology is getting tweaked out, it's all the quads are becoming these weird round things. But if I go to bilinear, we'll snap right back into this just being individual cubes. And now we have this noise that we can change its animation, change it to 2, go in there, change its height here if we want to. Change sides here, actually. Well, all right, cool. So we've got this whole thing going on, and that's basically the first iteration of what a tool that I later as a challenge to myself went rebuilt into Houdini. But let's go ahead and build how the membrane was driven. All right, so I'm gonna go ahead and hit Shift-Z, and I'm gonna have to speed mode this because I'm gonna stick the landing, I swear. I'm gonna drop a plane. I'm gonna drop an XP system. I'm gonna drop a displacer. I'm just dropping all the ingredients for the thing that I know I need to do. What we're gonna be doing here is cheating X particles into creating a hyperknotted loop or a hyperknotted gradient on our plane object. And we're gonna use the world speed of our mesh, our little object here. We're gonna use the world speed of this displacer to drive the color value of the particles themselves. So why I just set this stuff up. Let's get that going. All right, let's make sure our particles are coming out. Emitter, object. Let's make it editable. Ah, should probably give it the object. There we go. Okay, now let's go ahead and drop an XP color modifier. You saw that it immediately changed the color to white. You guys probably can't see this, they're probably really small. So under display, I'm gonna switch over to the second sexiest thing to see particles as cubes, slightly better than dots. You can change the display size factor. We'll bring it down a little bit. XP color, we're going to do a gradient by parameter. I'm gonna go speed world, and then under our emitter, under extended data, we're gonna enable world speed to show up in the spreadsheet. And now, let's go ahead and go to our displacer, hop in here, set animate, go to our XP color, let's kind of bring down the speed, and then under our displacer, so we don't want that stuff to move, because in our animation, that didn't move, it just looked like it had a weird fall-off range that was flowing across the surface. So if I just make this displacer almost do nothing, in the words of Paul Rudd, do less, and it's just sitting there. These particles are, for all intents and purposes, not doing anything. I can go back to my XP color, set it to a similar factor, and get this animation. So let's get a wild gradient knot in here, and let me just use this to explain why I do this. I'm going to kill some of these on the front and the back. Noises inherently are just a 0 to 1 float value, right? So if you wanted to remap that into like a crazy complicated system, you'd have to use a bunch of, you'd have to layer a whole bunch. This is too crazy. Whoa. Okay. So I'm filling in that 2D space, that 3D space of noise with all these various colors, and I'm using the front and the back here to sort of like clamp and eat away at what color values we're getting. And we're being able to visualize what's happening in all this noise space a lot more interestingly, in my opinion. And if we go ahead and go to our displacer, the noise that we're creating is we're basically visualizing the animation, movement, and speed of the noise that's displacing this floor. So if we change our scale to something like this, we're suddenly getting this like wild heat map looking effect that we can completely dial in however we want, using whatever we not want, however many dots, however many colors. We can erode and make like really trippy stuff. And so this was the basis of how we started creating this living membrane look. Again, like path of least resistance, find the thing that works really simple. And then if you want to add on to this to make it even crazier, which we did, it's your footwork is already in the concept of the idea where you're like, you're driving and living in this world of noise. That being said, I'm going to go ahead and play the last video, which was the non-animated or the non-hardware one. It's the one that we delivered. It's called Endpoints. It is called Anthem. So you guys see all the subdivided stuff everywhere and all the particles, all with the different noises living in anime on the surface. It was really just like, my secret is make a big interesting shape, move your camera around it. I don't like characters. You'll never see me making something where a whole bunch of threads weave together to make a sock or a shoe. Like, it's just not gonna happen. But if you want something to dissolve, explode, float up into stuff, tear, rip, be dynamic in particle land, like, I'm happy to do it. But I love living in this world of, you know, being able to define what something looks like. Love it. I'm at 5131. I think Matthias is going to show up over here at one point. Thanks, everyone.